Bible to the English book of Galatians chapter 4 and verse 19. Galatians 4 and verse 19. The title of my message this morning is Until Christ Be Formed in You. Until Christ be formed in you. I know, like Christian, I know you are born again, I know you speak in tongues. I know you have accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. If you haven't, you are still a great way of coming. That is a level. One level is to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Another level is to commit yourself to Him, to be committed to Him as your Lord and Savior. A lot of Christians who have confessed Jesus as Lord, they think that that is all there is to do. That you're born again. I have accepted Jesus. But it's not just enough to accept Jesus. Are you committed to Him? There were different categories of people when Jesus was on earth who are following Him. Some guys followed Jesus Christ because of they knew He would meet their needs. They knew He would heal. They knew He would deliver because they saw that happening. He would open the eyes of the blind. They knew that He would provide bread. And that is all they could take from Him. They didn't know that He's much more than healer, savior, bread provider, deliverer. He is everything that you need, that you desire. He said, my children, for whom I traveled a day, it's like the woman who's pregnant. When the child is about to be born, there will be a family. Don't give them the neighborhood. It's actually, why did they call the neighborhood the neighborhood? Why did they just call it the living room? Because there's a lot of labor, laboring going in on inside that place. How many of you men have been there when your wife was about to deliver? You were in the hospital. You were in that room, you were there, you were in the hearing noise. Unless you are my priest, you are going to help very well. You are there. Where's the supposed to us? You are going to be. You are there. Praise the Lord. I'm still a lot of times doing that now. Praise the Lord. How many of you had the noise, the screams, the pain, and you quietly walked away? You are there, but when you had the noise, you couldn't bear it. You took the walk, and that's your hand. Almost the same number of people. Praise the Lord. It is not easy. I thank God that most of the times I was not there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But there were some times I was around, but I was not there. There's a difference between being around. You are in the premises. The way it's happening, you are not there. Praise the Lord. The soul of one person is so important to God that sometimes it takes a lot of effort, investment, traveling for one soul to be established. Why is the soul of a person important? As beautiful as big as the whole world is, I'm talking about you now, talking about you, your soul. Your own soul that sometimes you are careless about. It's so important to God that Jesus Christ has come and died for you personally. And Jesus said, what shall he profit the man? He gains the whole world, for that's what we are looking for. Your life is not just about having a certificate, getting a job, getting married, procreating, getting old, become patient, send back to the village, to go and die. So there's a time when the Lord begins to reject you. And when the Lord begins to reject you, it will reject you. Then you start thinking about home. Say, I think I don't want to die in Lagos. I want to move closer to my people. Your life is such a fact. There is more about your life than yourself. He said, I travail again. The Christ is formed. Underline the word formed. Because you see another word, transformed. So it is transformed by the renewing of our mind. He said that you should not conform to this world, but you should be transformed. We should conform to the image of Christ. All the going to church, all the building of churches, all the equipping of facilities is because you are so important to God. Hallelujah. Amen. All the training, all the Bible schools that are opened, all the calling that comes upon people is because souls are so important to God. Your soul is important to God. And if you do anything and everything to get to heaven, including Jesus dying on that cross. The Bible talks about those who are called. It says we are called to conform to what? The image of Christ. This is a divine metamorphosis. Who he called? He first of all predestinated you. Then he called you. Then he justified you. That he might glorify you. So it's a metamorphosis. Predestinated, called, justified, and be glorified. We are all going through that process. I don't know what level you are today. What level are you now? Many are the level of just accepting Jesus, but not being committed to him. We are called, first of all, to be like him in all things. I said a lot of business trying to do a lot of things for God. Listen to me. I keep saying this, and I've said this several times. You are not called to do as much as you are called to be. Your being can only be a function. I mean, your doing for him can only be a function of your being. That's what we are called human beings. We are called to be like him. They don't call us human beings. Hallelujah. Amen. We are called, first of all, to be like him in all things, as imitators of Christ, as their children of God. You have to become like him before you can do like him. You see, I have them. Have you noticed that? It is to the degree that you be like him, that you can do like him. To the degree that you be like him, to that degree, to that extent, you can do like him. So if you are trying to do like him, far lesser than you are trying to be like him, that is the reason the sons of Sceva were dealt with by demons. In this kingdom, assumption is not permitted. You can't assume. You cannot assume. Say, I thought, I assumed. No. There is no room for assumption. This is not science. Even the science. The science before the computer, that was the words. Experience. In all science, there must be a process of experiment, because experiment in science is the mother of science. The practical Christian life is to be like Jesus in all things. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6 says, growing up into Him in all things. We are called to a life that prepares us for where we are going. It is a great mistake for you as a Christian to think that, I'm going to church. No, it's not enough to go to church. The reason why I go to church is to be like Jesus. The reason why I study the Bible is to know Him. If you don't know Him, you can't make Him know. It is on the essence that you know Him, and you can make Him know. I'm not talking about any place and other people who go to church. No, I'm talking about the practical aspect of it. I know him. Paul said, I know who I have believed and I have persuaded that what I have committed to him is able to give against that day. We must be interested in developing and nurturing your own Christian life. Because there are many people, what they call it as salvation, not stand the test of time. God will test, God will try us and challenge us. Mind you, Jesus has never promised us that there will be no challenges. He never promised that with all the men of Moses, there will be challenges. The moment you want to live the life of Christ, the power of this world will challenge you. I don't think they don't know what to have done. Matthew chapter 2 verse 2 says, there were people that came to Jesus, and what did they say? They said, we have seen his stars. Your stars are not that one morning. Every one of us. And why is your star not that one morning? So you don't become like him. So you don't become what God has called you to become. That is why. Jesus has the baby. People who are living. Almost 1,000 kilometers away. They say what? We have seen his stars. No reason why they are looking at your star is to stop you from being like him. Let me tell you what. Every person that was born into this world, God has an agenda, he has a purpose for you. There's a risk he brought you here. There are things he has called you to become. But those who wash your star, they go to work, they say, we'll never do that. They say, well, go back again. Not know we are alive. You have seen demons confess that, that boy has a great star. They're supposed to be this. How do they know? Because they saw it. Somebody do this, so we cannot allow you to become what you want to become. But when you follow Jesus, you have become unstoppable. They cannot stop you.
Amen.
When Christ is formed in you, to what extent has he been formed in us? That is what matters. To the extent that is formed in you, we see how you act, how you behave. You know that this one is still work in progress. Christ is not yet formed in this one, he's still struggling. Because when God calls us through his Son, Jesus Christ, he has an agenda. The purpose of that is that when we are born into this world, many of us forgot the purpose of God. Our parents didn't understand it either. You are born in an environment where they didn't understand your mission. And you are growing up in that environment where they are busy giving your vision. When you come to Jesus, the vision comes alive again. You will now begin to discover the purpose. Why am I here? What on earth was I born to accomplish?
discover that, your eyes will be opened. The enemy will now try to look at you. Ha! He has known that his call to become this. He has known finally. Then you go to work again. God punish the devil. Make an effort to stop you. That is why when you give your life to Christ, you are now finding definition and purpose for your life. Then the enemy says, oh, will this one escape like this? They go to work. That is why we face challenges, opposition in this world. That is why there is harassment, suffering, persecution. But if you know who you have received, that is not enough to stop you. Knowledge is power. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In Romans 12:2, he said, be not conformed to this world, then be transformed by the renewing of your mind as you hear the word of God. Is there any transformation going on in your life? The enemy knows your level now. And if he cannot stop you, he will not mind to keep you at this level. And God is saying, no, you are coming out here. Don't stay at this level. I brought you to this point. I'm still taking you somewhere. The enemy said, no, let's stop you. But Jesus Christ said, grow up into me in all things. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The devil knows that the Holy Spirit. Number one, I told you, they see your star. They know your level. People know Christ. They know how hot or how cold you are. They are looking at you. We are under monitor. There are actual projections. Be on the line. The satanic satellites that is monitoring you as a person. And it's like, oh, this one we have lost him. So it was still pursue. The devil also believes in pursuing, overtaking, and without fear. Coming on. He believes in scripture. Let me tell you what it is. Satan has nothing he can use. When he looks at the Bible, because the devil knows the Bible more than a lot of Christians, he knows how to apply biblical principles to his own advantage. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do you know that if an unbeliever is dealing with it, you don't know that. If an unbeliever, because there are supernatural laws, they work for anybody. They work for anybody. The devil also understands supernatural laws. He knows the power of unity. And he knows what he can accomplish with division. Even God knows that. So keep them divided. If it's a person, he can keep the person divided because man is a spirit. He has a soul, and he needs to come to the Lord. The three that form a man may not be united. As long as I don't know united, the guy is not coordinated. The spirit of confusion is one with him to ensure that his mind is not coordinated. That is why it is possible for a man who has gone to a heart. He's walking on the street. Papa is walking in the road. Paul is this way. He's not deaf, but his mind is so nice. Ah, do this man! Don't be honest. My mind has gone like this. You are seeing the body, but the mind is so nice. Another example, when a person sleeps, maybe for just 5 minutes, he can find himself how the soul moves. Your soul can count the brain. That is how it is. And as you wake up, you are in America, in that dream, you went everywhere, you did everything, and you are so real, so clear. Then you wake up, you still find yourself sitting in the church. Hallelujah. What happened? A part of you travels to America. Only your body is left here. There is a part of you also that feels pain. That's your soul. It's the seat of your emotion, your intellect, and your will. When the Bible says the soul that sinned shall die, it means that as I'm here now, God forbid, if I stop breathing, this body, it will not do anything for you. If you put fire, I will feel it. Why? The part of me that can feel the fire is not inside anymore.
So when you say a person's soul goes to hell, the part of him that will feed the fire is the one that goes to hell. This body is useless. If you put fire on it, you cannot feed it. But if the soul is in hell, it's screaming and crying. So a person can be divided into three: spirit, soul, and body. And the devil is a master of internal division. So I'm people confused. Which God do you want to do? Honestly, I don't know. And that is why, as a child of God, you cannot live your life in this world without God guiding you. The biggest risk we are taking is the risk of not hearing God. And the thing that we pray for more than anything here is that every one of us will develop ourselves, will be transformed in such a way that as Jesus was hearing God when he was on earth, we also can hear God if at this moment for yourself. The biggest confusion of mankind today is inability to hear God. Some people don't have to hear God. Hallelujah. Okay, let's do a test. How many of you know how to hear God? Raise up your hand. Raise up your hand. Praise the Lord. God bless the rest of you. It's not a sin, but you need to know it. How to hear God. How many of us dreamed? Talk about another you have dreamed before. Wake your hand up. You have never dreamt in your life. Raise up your hand. Raise your hand up. Like this, like I'm doing. Above your head. If I've ever dreamt before, you slept and you had a dream, raise up your hand. If I've never dreamt before, there's a problem. That I've never had a dream. Ah, brother, you need to start dreaming. Go back to bed. Go and sleep. Maybe you are not sleeping. If you are sleeping, you will dream. You have to dream. The Bible says that you are dreaming. One of the ways God can speak to you. You know a lot of things. Let me tell you one thing. One day I'm going to teach you about dreams. Because there's a lot of blessings in dreaming. There's a lot of things that, not just to dream, to interpret your dream. Because there's a lot of damage the devil is doing to people who cannot interpret their dreams. They just sleep and dream. So I don't even understand it. And then it comes to pass. You can stop people dream. God can use dreams to reveal the plan of the enemy. Hallelujah. Amen. Even the bad dreams. Bad dreams. What does that bad dream say? It exposes the enemy. Am I coming with this? When you have a bad dream, it's also good. Because when you wake up, you say the name of Jesus. God against the dream. Bad dreams are ways God exposed for the instruction. And you know what? The dream will be so real, you will be afraid. You will get up. You want to do something. You just get up. Hey! You are panting, you are sweating. What kind of a dream is this? What kind of a dream is this? And it takes Jesus. And it takes Jesus. And it takes Jesus. As you are doing that, you are stopping that evil dream from coming to pass. All those and it takes Jesus say, the carry power of God. If you do nothing about it, you can see it come to pass. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And all this thing will happen when you are transformed. Those things are the devil that you are. If you cannot fly, run. If you cannot run, crawl, or walk. If you cannot walk, crawl, move. Move! You have to move. You can't stay where you are spiritually. You must change your level until Christ is fully formed in you. Let me tell you one thing, that demons you cannot pass out until you get the particular level you are with God. The sons of Sceva were wounded. You were wounded for their transgressions. You were bruised for their iniquities. Hallelujah. Not the sons of Sceva. Their father was a priest. When they saw people casting out devils, they said, hey, you this demon. They don't organize a deliverance for someone.
and put him in the room and locked the room. And they were sending, they thought it was by number. So they surrounded the person who was possessed. In the name of Jesus, that Paul was talking about. Oh yeah, come out. And the demon said, I want to say something to you guys. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. Well, I know they will bless you. So you cannot cast me out. And the demon cast them out. They left their clothes. At the end of the day, the number of clothes that were left behind were enough for that demon to open the boutique. They left their clothes. They ended up being losers. They were wounded. When they are not who they are suiting themselves to be. People get wounded when they assume who they are not. There are a lot of wounds that are necessary. If you want to function in that office, grow up in it.
Declare yourself a professor when you are not had admission to university.
Somebody is doing about college and they're from, and their college from is cash. They are not passed down. Professor is not yet formed in him. So the enemy knows their level. He knew the sons of Sceva, he knew their level. He knew they were not qualified to do what they were trying to do. Because Christ was not yet formed in them. It is Christ that is formed in you that is the hope of glory. There's a level you get to look and say, well, I know who I believe and I'm passing. There's a level you can get to look and say, Christ in me is the hope of glory. There's a level you get to look and say, yeah, greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. All the promises of God in the Bible, they are for us to have to God. But there is a level you cannot apply the years. And that's what Jesus can tell chapter 4 verse 1. He said, I'm here. Who is in here? The person who is supposed to take over the inheritance. As long as he is in my God. Many people are my God. Spiritually, they are minus. Not minus, so as M-I-N-U-S-O. Minus. As in M-I-N-O-R-S. Who is the minor? Praise the Lord. The child. Praise the Lord. Come. 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 Let me pray. Okay. You can say this one is really minor. The most secret of the just 9 years old, even though she's tall, tall, beautiful girl, but she's just 9 years old. Now, we cannot give this girl, because we're having her. If you're like, if our father has a camera, he can't give her a key to go drive. If he drives, road safety will arrest her. She is a minor, they cannot put her in jail, but the car will be parked in their compound. The car will be arrested. The father may have given her the car, but she cannot take possession because she doesn't have a license to drive. Hallelujah.
Amen.
She may want to drive, love to drive, but she cannot drive yet because she is not old enough to drive a car. So what happens? They keep the car with those who are mature until such a time she grows up. If she doesn't grow, cannot take it. Pass it down. So there are some things that God has promised us. There are promises of God for us. They are ours, but we cannot assume them. We can take them over. Why? We are not showing maturity yet. That the mention of blessings that God has spoken, that have been prophesied. prophesied over your life, but until you show enough maturity, you will never be able to step into it. It's yours, so it's a promise of God, but you will never be able to take hold of it until such a time. Because a person can receive Christ, but 10 years after, he's still not believing. Imagine a boy who was born in 1989, that is almost 17, 18 years, 19 years. And that boy is still carrying the bottle all over the place. This on the camera, you know that it just to the bottom. That's a little. Put the table. You sit in the front of your house, sit down. What will you say? And you start crying. So, oh, this is where you need to change the diapers. 19 year old boy. You carry the shirt for the deliverance. Of the father, who did I offend? Why should you give me this kind of a child? What is my offense? Why should this kind of a child come to my family? That is what many Christians have become to Jesus. 3 years, you know, he spoke to the disciples. He said, how long will I be with you? How long has he been with them? It's not even up to 3 years. Which means that 2 years is enough for you to grow into maturity. He asked them, they couldn't cast out the devil. Cast out the devil. The devil defeated them. When he came from the mountain, he met them, struggling with the devil. I think Matthew chapter 7. He said, bring the shirt to me. How long will I be with you? That Jesus said, I've been with you guys for over 2 years now. You see all these things. What kind of apprentices are you guys? And this level that you have 5 years. 3 years to disciple, and all they intend to learn, they learn for such a lesson that Peter was mature enough to take over the ministry with the other disciples. So, if you have been born again 2-3 years ago, and you are still running around with diapers, and with the bottle, it's time for somebody to collect that. Why? Because there are great and good things to do. Praise the Lord. If a child is going to grow, the Bible says the child will be under tutelage. You will be under tutors. And let me tell you one thing, there are all kinds of tutors. You went to school like you went to school. There are teachers in the life. All kinds of tutors. Many things will be used to teach you. To train you by force. Until you grow up and graduate. Some of the children are born in primary school. I think almost all of them are dead. The ones that are not dead, they are very, very old. If I look at them, I say, this man used to beat me. He used to flaunt me. You look at the woman, say, you. What they have to do? A small woman, they can't take the blood person. It's suffering to be so. It has to be like that. Until I grew up, now can they beat me again? Why? I'm grown up. There are challenges that have been beating you, flaunting you, wounding you. But the moment you grow up, you go back and say, sorry, don't try that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Those of you are brilliant. Before you used to bring cane, you beat the child. But now, even yourself, you don't be carry cane again. You just look at the child. Say, I will beat you. I will beat you. I will beat you. When the person is as tall as yourself.
Not that you are really afraid, but you are still afraid.
You can't. Look this guy. Before you, I will beat you, but nice. You. Why?
She has grown up. She has not grown up. There are some children now, they are grown up, you want to beat them. You raise the cane, you just hold your hand, and mommy, don't do it.
You are the one that is saying, beat my hand. You are holding my hand. Do you want to beat me? You are the one that wants to beat me. I am the one that wants to beat me. You are letting the cane from you.
Yes.
Is that the one that came back for you? You don't need to start saying that. You now start telling lies. I'm the one that came back for you. No matter how you come, I will keep it to you. That's what all the life that even the devil cannot give them assignments. Even when they say Satan, I want to I told you now, I saw your spark. This is your way. I don't think I can use you because you will disappoint us. Even the devil himself, he wants commitment, he wants loyalty. Praise the Lord. And by shaking the kingdom of the devil, I'm sorry to say, is far organized, more organized than the kingdom of God on earth here. Why is it so? The devil knows that the moment he allows this organization in his kingdom, there will be trouble. And number two, he also knows that your own kingdom is stronger. And the lost thing he cannot afford is to allow you to be united. That is why he sent the spirit of division, the spirit of confusion, intimidation, and manipulation into the body of Christ. Even just one person, he cannot coordinate himself. It's not coordinated. He doesn't even understand his mind. Why? The spirit of confusion has been sent to run from him anywhere he goes. He just doesn't know why it's happening. He said, ask him, he's always there, I'm confused. He's telling you the truth, he's confused. And our God is not the God of confusion. Hallelujah. So the new creator wants me that Christ Jesus continues to work in us and through us. It means that we have not sharpness of his expression. It means that we have not of his ambassadors. The Bible says we are ambassadors of Christ. Hallelujah. But we have to trust in him, rely on him, absolute plan B. Totally. You have to come to that point. When he says, he that believeth in him, this sign shall follow them, he still made the same. In my name, they shall cast out devils. He didn't give us the number of devils. As many devils as are available, they have to be cast out. They shall lay hands on the sick. Do you know they shall lay? We simply don't believe what we claim. We don't believe what we say. We don't believe in the Lord. That is why when someone is sick, the first thing we talk about is attributing to the hospital, not attributing to Jesus. But when something has happened in the hospital, some doctor says there is nothing else we can do, the person wants to be, then you attribute to Jesus. What that is. You should read the first and the last, not just the last. Not when the first has prayed and said, we cannot do it. We will come upon the name of the Lord. Let's tell you what the people of God. Some of the sicknesses, the afflictions that we know in this world, they are demonic. Demons are behind them. Now they are holding up full deliverance ministry. You see the demons confessing. Then yes, I'm the one that gave you an attention. I gave you an attention. Because I want to kill you. He gave me hypertension. The man did not know how he developed hypertension. Did he say, do you not sleep? Do you take? He said, I don't take. I don't have any problem. But he's not having hypertension. It's a donation for the day. That's why I came to sleep last night. Because when I sleep last night, we need to do something else. But if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, and they were, I go to bed tonight. But I tell you, you don't need to know. That day I have my head of the day, give it to the rest. Before we do it last morning. And there are other people because they are worried, they are concerned about everything. The devil is disturbing them. He cannot sleep. Insomnia, sent in. He's awake all the time. He's the night, he's in the dark. Everything that happened in the neighborhood in the night, he knows. He's not sleeping. He's the unappointed, self-appointed beggar. Sleep, you don't sleep. Rest, don't rest. Hallelujah. When you are sensing people, I think of new power. Hey! The power is already available, but it must grow into that power. He says, I think of new power to show your servants that you can say, I transfer power to you. It's like this. If I say, I transfer 10,000 lives to account, the money is there in advance. If you don't see a lot, you may not know that you have the money, isn't it? Right? If you don't receive a lot, telling you that money has been transferred to your account, you keep on saying, what? I don't have money. This is a very tough one. It was like the case of a guy whose father, when the father was going to die, the father was a Christian. So the father did the wrong thing.
The father was wealthy, so he knew he was going to take over everything. But when the father died, before he died, he said, "My son, I have only one. I'm going to give you something." He gave him what? A Bible. By the time he went out after the father's death, he discovered that almost all the businesses have been sold. He came back angry. He said, "Why? What kind of a useless Christian father is this one? He left nothing for me. Is it Bible that I will eat? Now Bible I go show. Oh, what a useless." He was lamenting. He didn't open the Bible for us. It's money that I need. It's cash. Is that not what a lot of Christians are doing today when they come to church? Go and do evangelism. They say, "Will God give us money? If you give me cash, I will serve you." They are not equating God with money. It's salt. They are equating God with money. I was at Shoprite yesterday. I saw a lady fighting those who sell tickets. They didn't have back. That the money was too dirty. But they shouted, "You don't know what the top customer experience. You don't have three customers." Was fighting in it. I look at him. I said, "Somebody who is in the hospital is not the one. Somebody doesn't know I have money like that. It's not the one that they just look for it. Better money and then they say, "Yes, at least I got what I want." And then she walked away. From above, I just looked at her. I looked at her and said, "This kind of woman, I don't know who sits down for a woman, any man has to." That's the reason why some women can't get off money. The moment he had an encounter with the guy, he had a place, he went for dinner. The guy is so big, as she didn't know. As she didn't know, she's pumping everybody out in the restaurant. The last time she went to that place was asking for more. Now, somebody is going to pay the bill. Hey, you don't have a shot. You don't have a shot. You don't have a fist. You don't have a shot. Come back here. Are you saying that you don't have a dollar price? So now, what do you have? Okay, go and keep me. Now somebody can be a this group. Put the man in the basin. We eat food of 5,000 and the guy is talking her. This one that they want to 5,000 this day. This one that's too much infrastructure. I will never accomplish anything with this kind of a woman. And the guy has given his kiss. Look at it. I don't think I can manage it.
Yes.
I can manage it. They will feed it. They will go. After that. Hello, our friend. The line will go off. Say, what is wrong with our friend? Our friend is not speaking my talk. You already put our friend in the sea. I just want to do this kind of thing. That is what I hear you by here now. So that when John comes now, he will not go through the same experience. If you check it, that lady that was fighting there, go and check it, she will be a Christian. Because we Christians will know our right to. Go and check it, who is fighting with conduct?